subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
For the first time, the WHO has approved and recommended a groundbreaking malaria vaccine for children. This recommendation follows a long clinical trial in sub-Saharan Africa in the countries of Ghana, Kenya, and Malawi. And these trials had enrolled over 800,000 children for over 2 years. The trial for the vaccine, called Mosquirix, the brand name, formerly called RTSS-AS01, showed that among children who received 4 doses, the vaccine prevented over 40% of cases for 4 years. Children under the age of 5 are the most vulnerable to malaria, and this vaccine is now to be administered from the age of 5 months. This vaccine is not very hard to manufacture, and over 2.3 million doses have actually already been administered in these 3 African countries. There is also another vaccine candidate that has had promising results, but the findings have not yet been peer-reviewed. That one is called R21, and the trials were on in Burkina Faso. Now, the approval of this vaccine, the RTSS vaccine, is an enormous step in public health in the history of humanity, and it is a landmark achievement. In this video, we'll see why it is so by discussing briefly how the parasite and the disease have haunted humanity through ages and have been difficult to treat and prevent. Malaria is an old disease that has plagued humanity forever. In 2019, there were 229 cases of malaria worldwide, and there were over 400,000 deaths. Approximately 95% of the cases and deaths occurred in sub-Saharan Africa. The occurrence of the disease is also going up in this region from 2015. India has about 50% of all malarial deaths outside of sub-Saharan Africa, and it has about 85% of the case burden of malaria in Southeast Asia. A majority of malaria in the country occurs most commonly in 5 states. Odisha leads this list, followed by Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, and Maharashtra. Transmission of malaria mostly takes place during the monsoons and just after the monsoons, when mosquitoes breed in all the rainwater. So this happens from about the months of June to December. Malaria as a disease is also very, very closely associated with poverty and degrading economic development. The healthcare costs can be quite steep. There are 2 major kinds of malaria: uncomplicated and severe. If there are symptoms like loss of consciousness or strokes or breathing issues, kidney failure, a very steep blood sugar drop, acidosis, or anything that's serious, that kind of malaria is categorized as severe. Otherwise, all other forms are just categorized as uncomplicated malaria. The infection goes through the liver first after a person is infected, and the parasite multiplies in the liver. It then remains dormant in the liver for some time, and then after a brief period, all these new parasites escape out again into the bloodstream and infect red blood cells. When they start to multiply in red blood cells, we start having symptoms. The classic symptom, of course, is fever, and it is periodic. The parasites multiply periodically in waves in the red blood cells. As soon as a bunch of these newly multiplied parasites are released into the bloodstream, there is fever that follows as an immune response, and this happens periodically. Malaria patients typically do not tend to have any kind of liver dysfunction later on. The symptoms of malaria are also very vague and general, and they make it hard to diagnose for the disease. There's of course fever, low platelets, and enlarged spleen, and the results can actually be confused for various other diseases, including other mosquito-borne diseases like dengue. Diagnostic tests that check for antigens is what produces a conclusive malaria diagnosis. The treatment for malaria varies from place to place depending on what kind of malaria there is, but there hasn't been anything that is extremely effective and continues to remain so. Chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine stopped being effective decades ago as the parasites are no longer sensitive to it. Some medications like mefloquine, doxycycline, proguanil are all given as anti-malarial medication, and there are many other quinine-based drugs as well, like piperaquine, tafenoquine and amodiaquine, which are all used for uncomplicated malaria. Severe malaria cases typically receive critical care with IV malarial drugs. With this vaccine, there has been a reduction of 30% in cases of deadly severe malaria. Now, drug resistance has also been a problem both with malaria and with mosquitoes. Malaria prevention in the form of mosquito netting, insecticide, and more is also considered to be an effective and necessary step for the prevention of the disease. Malaria is a prehistoric disease, which means that it existed before written records started being kept. It is present in every single part of the world, on every continent except for Antarctica. The oldest dated evidence we have for malaria is that of mosquitoes preserved in amber going back about 30 million years. The discovery was made by the famous American entomologist George Poynard Jr., who established the method of extracting DNA from insects that are fossilized in amber. His work through the 80s was in fact the inspiration for the Mr. DNA scene in the movie Jurassic Park, which is based on the premise of extracting dinosaur blood from a mosquito that's preserved in amber. With this method, we've known that the disease malaria has existed for so many millions and millions of years. At some point in our evolution, the disease jumped from higher apes, other primates, to humans. Then about 10,000 years ago, humans domesticated plants. Or if you're a fan of Sapiens, plants domesticated humans. This period where humans transitioned from an entirely hunter-gatherer society to establishing agricultural settlements is called the Neolithic Revolution. At this point, we know that malaria started to have a really great impact on humans because we can see it in our own body's history. We can trace natural selection for defenses against malaria. Natural selection essentially means that those who have advantages, genetics or physiology, tend to survive, and because they survive more, they pass on these modifications to their offspring. For malaria, there are various kinds of inherent natural defenses that our bodies have now, depending on what part of the world we are in. Sickle cell anemia is a common one, which is a blood disorder and is genetic. In people who have this disease, hemoglobin, the protein that carries oxygen in our blood, is deformed to a sickle shape. This results, of course, in things like anemia, but also a lot of other side effects like swelling and other infections. But the low blood oxygen means that there usually isn't enough oxygen for some kinds of malarial parasites to grow and replicate. So it sort of offers a partial natural defense against malaria. There are other genetic blood disorders as well, which are prevalent today and which we can trace back to Neolithic societies, such as thalassemia, which is a genetic blood disorder with extremely low levels of hemoglobin production. Or there is the Southeast Asian ovalocytosis, which, as the name suggests, causes red blood cells to become oval-shaped and of course also results in anemia. Low blood oxygen, low iron, and anemia. All of these confer partial resistance to malaria, the disease, not necessarily the infection, by any of the Plasmodium parasites. When we started keeping written records, malaria was everywhere. Ancient Greece, ancient Rome, ancient Egypt, ancient India, ancient China, it was found everywhere with a tropical and temperate climate. We can see records of the disease being described, and we can also see records of preventive measures being taken. In ancient Egypt, when the pyramids were being constructed during about 2500 BCE, there was a lot of use of garlic to prevent malaria. Cleopatra slept under a mosquito net. King Tut, the boy king, is also thought to have had a malarial infection at some point. And of course, we also have DNA confirmation that since the year of 800 BCE, there definitely was malaria here in Egypt. In India, during the Vedic period in the subcontinent, which is from about 1500 BCE to about 800 BCE, malaria was described in writings, and it was in fact described as the king of all diseases. In Europe too, Homer mentioned it in his famous work, The Iliad, in 750 BCE. Aristotle mentioned it in 350 BCE and Plato has mentioned it too. During about 450 BCE, the father of medicine, Hippocrates, started to associate the disease with seasonality and also with the periodicity of fevers, which he was the first to document. Later, Rome suffered really deadly malaria outbreaks. And in around 5th century CE, what was called the Roman fever, an extremely deadly strain of malaria, is what is thought to have ultimately brought down the Roman Empire. In China, in 250 CE, there started to be herbal remedies throughout for it. And of course, through the Middle Ages and later, once the age of discovery and colonization began, colonizers spread the disease to all parts of the world. By the 1700s, malaria was a common disease everywhere with regular outbreaks in the Americas and in Europe. And yet, since then up until now, the deadliest toll that malaria has had has always been on the sub-Saharan African population for centuries and centuries. Malaria was performed through the 1700s and 1800s during the birth of modern evidence-based medicine. A British army surgeon called Ronald Ross, who was working in Secunderabad, provided evidence in 1897 that mosquitoes were responsible for transmitting malaria. And for this, he won the 1902 Nobel Prize in Medicine as well. We all know today that it is spread by parasites belonging to the genus Plasmodium. Specifically, there are 5 species that spread malaria: Plasmodium falciparum, Malariae, Ovale, Vivax, and Nolesi. The most common species is the falciparum, and this vaccine is effective against falciparum. And the second most common infection is by the Vivax. Although the Vivax tends to be more deadly than falciparum, but falciparum is more common in Africa, whereas Vivax is more common outside. India, as we might all remember from our school times, is infected mostly by Plasmodium vivax and carries about 50% of the Vivax burden. The only animal host for malaria is the female Anopheles mosquitoes. Only the females feed on blood, males typically feed on plant nectar. These mosquitoes start being active after sunset and they bite through the night, but not during the day. The most common protective measures that we've taken, of course, have been preventative, which is mosquito nets, mosquito repellents, skin creams, shutting windows and doors, and so on. These are not 100% effective for an individual, even though they are an extremely effective public health measure. Additionally, when it comes to treatment, drug resistance is a big problem. Drug resistance is already a problem for mosquitoes as well, which became resistant to things like DDT. And we also know that the parasite starts becoming resistant to quinine-based drugs. So now we're also trying various genetic ways to alter mosquitoes and make the world a little safer for us. But the introduction of this vaccine is going to be a game changer for public health. And given the tremendous impact malaria has had on the history of humankind, the hope is that these preventive vaccines start helping us get away from this path of deadly malarial deaths that we have been on for millennia.